Hello and welcome to the Queen Elizabeth Patient Podcast. So I'm here today at the Prodo building with Dr. Peter Blackburn, who is an NHS consultant in clinical psychology who works in oncology and palliative care. He's interested in acceptance, compassion, values, guided living. And we're here today to discuss uncertainty. So Peter, thank you very much for coming today. Can you explain a little bit more about this and the topic that we're going to discuss today?
Yeah, firstly, thank you for inviting me. In the previous podcast, we looked at worry and its uses, why we worry and where it becomes unproductive. Today, we're going to look really at the engine of worry, which is uncertainty. That is what leads to us worrying when we doubt or we don't know something. And the more we can understand the power of uncertainty, and then more importantly, how to cope more effectively with it, will be helpful. It's normal to feel uncertain about your future, especially when you're stressed or have been diagnosed with cancer, but also in these times of COVID. Firstly, it's important to understand the role that uncertainty plays in worry. When we are uncertain, unsure, unclear about something that we think is mildly important to exceptionally important, it triggers worry. The aim of productive worry is to solve the uncertainty. However, if the uncertainty is not solved, probably because the threat is a long way off or is hypothetical, i.e. in theory it could happen, then uncertainty generates more unproductive worry and in turn leads to more uncertainty, and so it goes around with anxiety increasing. For people who cannot tolerate uncertainty, initially they try to avoid or eliminate it by seeking reassurance, making lists, avoiding certain activities or situations, or over-informing themselves. Rarely do these actions reduce uncertainty. It's important to observe that worry will continue despite efforts to increase certainty. This is because uncertainty is part of our life. It's very rare to be 100% certain of anything. For example, it is a good idea to visit your GP for regular checkups, but visiting often to try and detect any future problems will not guarantee that you will be healthy all of your life.
So Peter, am I correct in thinking that trying to increase certainty decreases our ability to tolerate uncertainty and only serves just to increase that worry? Or on the other hand, increasing your ability to tolerate uncertainty helps to decrease worry?
Yes. Let's take the example of Anna and Bridget. Both have recurring abdominal pain. Their GPs are unsure of the cause of the pain. And both Anna and Bridget agree to a referral for an ultrasound. Over the next few days, Anna thinks about the ultrasound, what it will be like, and what it might find, as a consequence, starts to worry, which makes her feel anxious. However, she reminds herself that she chose to have the scan, as it will help clarify the cause of her pain. Anna carries on with her daily activities and accepts that periodically she will worry about the scan, and also accepts the uncertainty of not knowing because it's not happened yet. And more importantly, a GP has not explained any results. On the other hand, Bridget wants to be absolutely certain about the ultrasound, so asks her GP many questions. She's very keen to be reassured that she does not have cancer. During the following days, Bridget constantly thinks about the forthcoming scan, predicting that she will be diagnosed with cancer, will have horrendous treatments with awful side effects, that she might even die, and her children will grow up motherless. To reduce her anxiety, she asks her partner and friends for reassurance and searches the internet for more information. However, despite everything she reads and is told, she constantly worries and feels anxious because she's not sufficiently certain to calm herself. Anna's able to continue her everyday life with some interruption by worry. However, she's able to recognise that she cannot be 100% sure and therefore accepts feeling uncertainty. Whereas Bridget is unable to tolerate not knowing, as it makes her very anxious. She attempts to get rid of her uncertainty by seeking reassurance or more information. However, reassurance by others often does not last long because we need to seek it out again and again. We need to reassure ourselves by trusting that we have done our best and learn to sit with uncertainty, that feeling of not knowing. Likewise, more information often leads to more uncertainty. Usually it does not reduce our doubts. Once again, it's about accepting, not knowing something 100%.
So, Peter, how can people reduce the power of uncertainty?
This is not easy, living with uncertainty. However, people can decide what they have control over, and that's their own behaviour rather than a potential disease or illness. They can undertake proportionate monitoring, engage in healthy behaviours, and read the information given to them by their clinical team. However, the most powerful way of coping with uncertainty is learning to live with it. We can do this in two ways. By exposure to fear, which involves approaching it. This works well for hypothetical or unsolvable worry. Exposure is a well-founded psychological treatment. It involves approaching or facing what is feared and staying with it until the anxiety subsides. This approach has been used for many anxiety problems such as panic, phobias, and obsessive-compulsive disorder. In their book, Overcoming Worry, Kevin Mears and Mark Freeston, who are clinical psychologists based at the Cognitive and Behavioural Centre in Newcastle, advise about writing down hypothetical worry. They say that this, understandably, is daunting. Most people predict that this approach will make their worry worse. However, all you are doing is transferring what is happening in your mind onto paper. Just because it's on paper does not increase the likelihood of it happening. Do you believe that writing down that you will win the lottery tomorrow will increase its likelihood of occurring? Mears and Freeston reassure the reader that this approach works, and this is my clinical experience too. They suggest that you write down your worry in as much detail as possible so that it would be possible for someone to make a film of it. Sometimes it seems like the worry is never ending. Just continue to write until you have passed what may be the worst moment for you. Remember, the aim is to be with uncertainty, not finding a happy ending. Therefore, aim for an end to be left open, as this will activate more uncertainty, which offers you the opportunity to learn to tolerate it. It's quite normal to feel upset while writing your script. The images and thoughts will quite possibly be awful, and the reason for this is that you care, and it is the last thing you want to happen. The next day, reread your script and check that you have not left out any details. Then find a quiet time of the day, not late at night, as worries can be magnified, and find a place where you will not be disturbed. Use a piece of paper to record your anxiety before and after reading your script. Then read your script for 30 minutes. It's understandable to be upset. Stay with the upset. And equally important, stay with the uncertainty you feel. You may need to do this exercise daily for 2 to 4 weeks. This is a powerful approach that requires courage and commitment. Remind yourself why you are doing it, and that's because learning to be with uncertainty rather than trying to get rid of it will reduce worry. This technique of writing down your worry and approaching it, being with the uncertainty, is challenging, but ultimately it offers the opportunity to be with uncertainty rather than to get rid of it, trying to solve it, which is impossible for things that haven't happened yet. So courage and determination are needed in bucket loads to do this. But once again, as I say, my clinical experience and the research will say this can be helpful. Another way to be with uncertainty is meditation. Meditation is about paying attention to something in the present moment without judging it. There is a podcast about meditation with a practice to help with uncertainty. So if we just think about today's podcast, Uncertainty Drives Worry, there is a chance that we can reduce uncertainty, maybe even get rid of it, if the worry is actually happening. But for worry that is hypothetical, that might happen, might never happen, then trying to get rid of that uncertainty by worrying only increases it, because you'll never be truly certain. That'll generate more worry, more anxiety, more uncertainty, and so it goes round. The solution is to let go of worry here and sit with that feeling of uncertainty, which is hard work, but it's the solution. And my hat goes off to you for your doing this for the first time.
That's great advice, Peter. I think a lot of people will get a lot from that, you know, regardless where they are on the pathway, what they're going through. And I think even if you aren't going through a cancer diagnosis or maybe looking up to somebody that's going through it, obviously there's some great points there to take away from. So thank you so much for coming today.
Thank you. And the two techniques, one that I'm advising it to learn to sit with uncertainty is writing about it. In the next podcast, it'll be about how meditation can help.
And I'm sure that'll be really helpful, Peter. So thanks again. Thank you.
Thank you.